This week at NASA. Each year, NASA honors the Apollo 1, Challenger, and Columbia crews, as well as other members of the NASA family whose lives were lost in the support of the agency's mission of exploration and discovery. This year's Day of Remembrance, February 1st, the 10th anniversary of the loss of Columbia, saw tributes held around the agency. Among them, a wreath laying at Arlington National Cemetery's Astronaut Memorial by NASA Administrator Charles Bolden and other senior officials. A memorial at the Marshall Space Flight Center's Morris Auditorium with guest speaker, astronaut and former Marshall engineer Jan Davis. The event included a moment of silence and a candle lighting ceremony. And a wreath laying ceremony hosted by the Astronauts Memorial Foundation, televised live on NASA television from the Space Mirror Memorial at the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex.
For many of us gathered here in Florida today, this commemoration is not only historic, it's also very personal. We remember the Columbia crew as colleagues, as friends, as parents, and as spouses.
And oftentimes, when lacking sufficient data, we make poor decisions. And that results in events like Apollo 1, Challenger, and Columbia. It's important that we pause to remember and reflect. We must do our very best to prevent something like that from ever happening again.
A special memorial tribute was also featured on NASA.gov. NASA thanks these fallen heroes and the families they left behind for their sacrifices in the service of our nation and America's space program. Media touring the Kennedy Space Center's SwampWorks Research Laboratories also got a photo op with the Orion spacecraft inside KSC's operations and checkout building, where it's being prepped for Exploration Flight Test 1, scheduled for 2014. Kennedy Director Bob Cabana updated attendees on the center's continuing transformation to a multi-use government and commercial space launch complex.
We have a plan. We are executing that plan, and we have made tremendous progress. We have a very positive path forward.
Orion, designed to take U.S. astronauts farther into space than ever before, will be propelled by NASA's new heavy-lift space launch system. The SLS is flexible enough to launch crew and cargo spacecraft from KSC and will enable new human missions of exploration beyond low Earth orbit and across the solar system.
And lift off.
The successful launch of NASA's new TDRS-K communications satellite on January 30th was also occasion for the Kennedy Space Center to host a two-day get-together for ardent users of social media. The select group of tweeps and other tech-savvy space aficionados heard from special guest speakers about NASA's continuing mission of exploration and discovery. Among them, Badri Yonis, the head of NASA's Space Communications and Navigation, or SCAN program, who outlined the role and advanced capabilities of the next-generation comm satellite.
We support all of the launches that take place here in the United States. We are preparing the stage for the future, as I said, to make sure that the future human exploration will be carried forward as contemplated, as planned.
The International Space Station will be getting a new instrument in 2014 that'll measure ocean surface wind speed and direction. The ISS RapidScat instrument will help improve weather forecasts, including hurricane monitoring and understanding of how ocean-atmosphere interactions influence Earth's climate. RapidScat is a clever repurposing of hardware originally built to test parts of NASA's QuickScat satellite that, until 2009, spent 10 years successfully collecting ocean and wind data. NASA wants your ideas on how the International Space Station can be better used to test new technologies. The agency's National Lab and Technology Demonstration Offices are taking proposals to develop advanced or improved exploration technologies aboard the world's only laboratory in microgravity. They'll also welcome your suggestions for improving the unique laboratory environment of the orbiting outpost. For details, go to http://go.nasa.gov/UQKCCZ. You've got till September 30th to weigh in. NASA Chief Technologist Mason Peck was briefed at the Dryden Flight Research Center on projects to develop technologies for next-generation aircraft and spacecraft. Peck says the transfer of such technologies will help fuel industry's future in space.
I think we're actually seeing for the first time the level of private investment in commercial space that we really haven't seen before, and that actually could indicate the start of a commercial space age. But NASA is right at the center of that.
Peck also visited several NASA partners at the Mojave Air and Spaceport, including Firestar Technologies, X-Cor Aerospace, and Maston Flight Systems. NASA's Flight Opportunities Program has contracted with Maston and X-Cor to fly promising technologies on suborbital space access vehicles, while Firestar has developed several technical innovations to benefit NASA via the agency's Small Business Innovative Research and Technology Transfer Programs. The first nanosatellite launch adapter system, or NLAS, has been shipped for integration for a launch expected in late 2013. Right now, nanosatellites can be deployed only in small numbers by rocket or from the International Space Station. But NLAS, developed by the Ames Research Center, can hold up to 24 cube satellites, opening up opportunities for smaller research projects to access space. NLAS is expected to be used by NASA, other government agencies, and commercial entities. Representatives from the Glenn Research Center joined media and the Cleveland Regional Transit Authority in braving single-digit temperatures to show off the system's new hydrogen-powered bus and Ohio's first operational electrolysis-based refueling station. Refueling at the bus's depot station eliminates the vehicle's need to lug large hydrogen-filled supply tanks. Glenn coordinated the technical effort that included contracting with the Sierra Lobo Corporation to install the refueling station. The project is sponsored by NASA's Space Technology Game-Changing Development Program. Marshall Space Flight Center and nearby Redstone Arsenal have both been awarded the designation of Storm Ready Community by the National Weather Service. The designation recognizes the work of both facilities to document their notification systems and severe weather preparedness. Weather Service officials were at the Arsenal to present Marshall and Redstone with their Storm Ready Community signs for their welcome centers.
The purpose of Storm Ready is just what it says. It's weather preparedness, safety, and awareness, and making sure that the communities are very much prepared for significant weather events that impact the area.
This is a great way to recognize all the hard work that's gone into this, to our facility, to be able to ensure that we have the best possible protection available for our employees.
Marshall is only the second federal location in Alabama to receive the Storm Ready designation.
My name is Sarita Weary. I'm the lead systems engineer for the Robotic Lunar Lander Development Project. I'm supporting the Warm Gas Test Article, now known as the Mighty Eagle. My duties as a lead systems engineer includes making sure that I understand the system and functions of the Mighty Eagle, as well as the most important thing is making sure that the vehicle is safe at all times. Diversity is important in NASA because it gives us a variety of backgrounds and cultures so that we can see the experiences, the values, and the ideas and opinions of other people who may be different within the organization. I look at my career and I look at all the things that I've accomplished, all the things that I've, the different projects that I've worked on, and what better way to culminate my career is being on the project that I'm on now. The Robotic Lunar Lander Development Project and supporting the Mighty Eagle. I've worked in NASA for 27 years. It's a project where it feels good when you can see things that happen, to see something that flies, to work on with a team of people who are very smart, very intelligent, and can actually develop something that flies. I love what I do. It's new to me, but it's an awesome experience, and this journey that I've had in Marshall Space Flight Center has been a great journey.
39 years ago, on February 5th, 1974, a flyby of Venus by Mariner 10 enabled the spacecraft to conduct atmospheric studies and collect photographs of the planet's extensive cloud cover. While Venus's clouds are nearly featureless in visible light, Mariner 10's ultraviolet camera filters captured them in never-before-seen detail.
We have main engine start, zero, and liftoff of the Stardust spacecraft.
And 15 years ago, on February 7, 1999, the Stardust probe launched atop a Delta II rocket from Florida's Cape Canaveral Air Force Station for a rendezvous with Comet Vild 2. Stardust became the first U.S. mission to a comet and the first ever spacecraft to bring back a comet sample when it successfully returned to Earth on January 15, 2006. And employees of the Marshall Space Flight Center commemorated this year's 40th anniversary of Skylab by hosting five astronauts who flew on America's first space station. Joe Kerwin, Paul Weitz, Ed Gibson, Gerald Carr, and Bill Poe shared their stories and highlights from their missions aboard Skylab. From May 1973 to February 1974, three crews occupied Skylab, a Saturn V rocket modified at Marshall. Its nine astronaut residents conducted human adaptation and materials experiments, as well as scientific studies of the Earth, Sun, and stars. The research they performed on Skylab then enabled the groundbreaking science being studied now aboard the International Space Station for the benefit of humankind. And that's This Week at NASA. For more on these and other stories, or to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and other social media, log on to www.nasa.gov.